गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबडी, आई एम डॉक्टर नितिन जोशी, प्रोफेसर न्यूरोलॉजी विथ टीचिंग एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ 25 ईयर्स, वर्किंग एज कंसल्टेंट न्यूरोसर्जन इन पनवेल। टुडे विल डिस्कस द टॉपिक सर्जरी ऑन किडनी इन प्रेजेंस ऑफ सिग्निफिकेंट पेरिरिनल स्कारिंग एंड फाइब्रोसिस। पेशेंट मे हैव सिग्निफिकेंट पेरिरिनल स्कारिंग एंड फाइब्रोसिस ड्यू टू रिपीटेड एपिसोड्स ऑफ इन्फेक्शंस, दैट इज पायलोनेफ्राइटिस, causing gross inflammation. There can be significant perirenal scarring and fibrosis even after previous surgery on kidney. These previous surgeries on kidney can be ureterocolecystomy or pyroplasty for PU junction obstruction, or nephron sparing surgery for renal cell carcinoma, or partial nephrectomy for non-functioning moiety of duplex kidney or even PCNA. The inflammatory process, hence scarring and fibrotic reaction, starts from renal parenchyma and then extends progressively outwards to involve renal capsule, then perinephric fat, then anterior as well as posterior layer of Girota's fascia, and then renal fat, that is pararenal fat, means just outside the Girota's fascia. There is a fat which is also called as the extraperitoneal fat. The fibrotic reaction, hence adhesions, may then extend from extraperitoneal fat posteriorly to muscles of posterior abdominal wall, that is psoas major, quadratus lumborum, and the aponeurosis of the transversus abdominis. Also, the fibrotic reaction, hence dense adhesions, between the retroperitoneal fat and the muscles of posterior abdominal wall then may result into the obliteration of retroperitoneal space. So, the opening of retroperitoneal space by blunt dissection by routine gradual insertion of 2 to 3 wet mops in whatever available retroperitoneal space may be impossible. Normally, there is a cleavage plane between parietal peritoneum and Girota's fascia anteriorly. However, due to presence of the spread of inflammatory fibrotic reaction, the inflammatory process will spread from Girota's fascia to the extraperitoneal pad of fat which is present between the Girota's fascia and the parietal peritoneum, and so this cleavage plane, which is due to presence of extraperitoneal fat, is also involved in the fibrotic reaction. So, the process of inflammation has started from Girota's fascia to extraperitoneal fat anteriorly, and then it will progress to parietal peritoneum and then even intraperitoneal organs and surrounding viscera. Thus, Girota's fascia and contents in Girota's fascia get densely adherent to peritoneum and even intraperitoneal organs or even surrounding structures. In case of right kidney may be adherent to second part of duodenum, liver, hepatic flexure of colon, ascending colon, and even loops of small intestine. Also, due to intense fibrotic reaction in retroperitoneum, inferior vena cava, which is present on the right side of midline, may be pulled more towards right kidney. While in case of left kidney may be adherent to spleen, pancreas, stomach, splenic flexure of colon or descending colon or even loops of small intestine. Also, due to intense fibrotic reaction in retroperitoneum, aorta, which is present on left side of midline, may be pulled more towards left kidney. Since patient with adherent kidney from any cause likely to have adherent bowel loops, preoperatively proper bowel preparation with pegleg is essential. This is because during separation of adhesions, there is a risk of opening of small intestine or large intestine. Preoperatively, if bowel is prepared properly, then even if intraoperatively, if there is opening of the bowel, it can be sutured immediately. Due to obliteration of retroperitoneal space and adhesion of Gerotas fascia with peritoneum after taking flank incision rather than retroperitoneum coming into picture, peritoneal envelope with its contents may come directly in view. The inflammatory fibrotic reaction may extend even upwards to involve diaphragm and pleura. So during mobilization, there is a risk of opening of pleura, which may require insertion of intercostal tube drain. So preoperatively, patient must be counseled for SOS need for intercostal tube drain insertion. Being difficult surgery, it is likely to be prolonged surgery, and hence prolonged general anesthesia with added risk of need of insertion of intercostal tube drain. Hence, preoperatively itself, patient should be started with spirometry with chest physiotherapy to prevent or reduce the postoperative chest complications. Due to possibility of gross adhesion of operative site surgery as well as dissection should be started in virgin area. So if the initial surgery is through 12th rib bed incision, then the new incision should be through 11th rib bed, that is one rib bed above the previous. Also, due to possibility of adhesions with multiple organs, incision should be generous for proper exposure. Also, partially resected rib of previous surgery, if causing hindrance, then for proper exposure, even the remaining rib also should be resected. Due to high incidence of adhesion with peritoneum and hence intraperitoneal organs and the loops of small intestine, in case of surgery with adherent kidney, deliberate and early opening of peritoneum under vision to prevent injury to intraperitoneal organs is essential. So approach becomes transperitoneal and incision becomes thoracoabdominal. That is, 11th rib bed incision can be extended forwards towards midline or even on opposite side depending upon requirement. During extension of incision on anterior aspect, as one approaches midline, one will have to cut anterior rectus sheath, rectus muscle and then posterior rectus sheath, followed by incision in peritoneum along the line of incision. With the help of two artery forceps, a fold of peritoneum is tented up. This fold of peritoneum is then palpated by fingers to confirm absence of any visceral organ, and then the fold of peritoneum is opened with 11 number blade or stele, and then the incision in peritoneum is extended along the line of incision. Due to multiple adhesions during their mobilization, always there is a risk of bleeding, and hence preoperatively keeping several units of group specific blood cross match standby ready is essential. Due to extensive mobilization and dissection and even intraperitoneal handling, there is high chance of prolonged paralytic ileus. So the patient may require prolonged hospitalization. Preoperatively, patient should be counseled for the same. Due to prolonged post-op paralytic ileus, patient may require hyperalimentation. Due to difficult surgery requiring prolonged duration, there is a risk of deep vein thrombosis. So to prevent this, intra-op crepe bandages to be applied to lower legs, and post-operatively, patient is encouraged for passive leg movements and exercises. So in case of surgery on kidney, in presence of significant perirenal scarring and fibrosis, dictum is generous incision, arrangement of more units of group specific blood, pre-op bowel preparation, pre-op chest physiotherapy, intra-op crepe bandages, early and deliberate opening of peritoneum under vision. Sometimes there is so much significant scarring on posterior aspect that Gerotas fascia and its content may become adherent to psoas fascia with almost hard cartilaginous tissue reaction. Here, sharp dissection with scissors, blades or cautery may be necessary. This is facilitated by finding a virgin plane below psoas fascia so as to mobilize stuck kidney from psoas major muscle. Then the Schwann's fascia is incised below the lower pole of kidney and ureter is identified at that level. And then this identified ureter is followed upwards towards renal hilum. Due to dissection below Schwann's fascia, Schwann's major muscle may start bleeding. Being muscular bleeding, it can be controlled by underrunning bleeding site by absorbable suture material. While mobilizing kidney stuck on posterior aspect, though cautery can be used, but while mobilizing stuck kidney on anterior aspect near intraparietal organ, avoid use of cautery due to proximity to bowel. Due to gross fibrotic sclerotic reaction posteriorly, Gerota's fascia and its content may be badly stuck to muscles of posterior abdominal wall, while anteriorly Gerota's fascia and its content may be badly stuck to peritoneum and intraparietal organs. So many a times to identify and open Gerota's fascia, one may have to mobilize ascending colon or descending colon medially along white line of told. Just posterior to mobilize ascending colon or descending colon will be Gerota's fascia and its contents. The most common surgery required in presence of such gross perirenal scarring and fibrosis is nephrectomy. Due to severe perirenal scarring, routine mobilization of kidney after opening Gerota's fascia longitudinally is not possible. This is because the fibrotic reaction obscures the normal anatomical relations between kidney and surrounding organs. Also, due to severe cicatrization around hilar vessels, finding renal artery, renal vein, and renal pelvis individually may be impossible. So, one may have to go ahead with subcapsular or intracapsular nephrectomy. Usually, capsule can be identified. This is because capsule becomes thickened due to repeated episodes of inflammation. Once the thick capsule is identified, a longitudinal incision is made along the lateral convex border of kidney. After incision in capsule, Allis forceps are applied to edges of incised capsule to retract the two edges, and then with finger, plane is developed between thickened capsule and renal parenchyma over the entire surface of kidney down to level of hilum. Due to complete dissection all over, now kidney remains attached only by scarred pedicle in hilar region. In non-functioning kidney, majority of the times renal artery becomes non-functioning and fibrotic, but renal vein is functioning. Extensive inflammatory cicatrization around renal vessels may make identification and isolation of renal vessels difficult. So, a pedicle clamp is applied across the pedicle and hilar structures and transected as close to kidney as possible. This is in contrast to radical nephrectomy or donor nephrectomy, where renal vessels are ligated and cut as laterally as possible. After removal of kidney, thick capsule which has been stripped off from renal parenchyma is incised in hilar region inside out. Due to this, renal artery and renal vein can be exposed separately as well as far laterally as possible. After separate identification and isolation of renal artery and renal vein, separate ligation of renal artery and renal vein may become possible. However, if this appears to be difficult, then pedicle is clamped en masse using two pedicle clamps, leaving sufficient tissue behind the clamps and kidney is removed. The tissue beyond the clamp can be picked up with forceps and main vessels ligated before removing the clamps. If this is impossible, then pedicle doubly ligated en masse with absorbable suture material like 10 vicryl or 20 vicryl. When first ligature is being tightened, deeper clamp is released slowly and removed. Now on proximal side, second ligature is applied and then tightened. That time the superficial clamp is released and removed slowly. While operating on infected kidney, one should avoid use of non-absorbable suture material like linen or silk. This is because in presence of infection and use of non-absorbable suture material, there is high risk of development of recurrent infection or persistent discharge in sinus, which heals only when non-absorbable suture material is extruded or removed. Due to gross adhesion to pleura, there is high chance of opening of pleura while operating on the adherent kidney. So one may require intra-op insertion of intercostal tube drain. Ideally, insertion of ICD tube is done through 6th intercostal space in mid-axillary line. Ludwig's angle corresponds to 2nd intercostal space. The intercostal space are then counted downwards. Through mid-axillary line in 8th or 9th intercostal space with 11 number blade, transverse incision is taken. The transverse incision is then deepened partially by 11 number blade and partially by artery forceps. Then the long pointed artery forceps is passed through thoracic incision towards abdominal incision, and close end of ICD is held with the artery forceps and pulled up, and then open end of the ICD having multiple holes is passed under vision or under guidance of fingers into pleural space. Care is to be taken to confirm that all holes of the ICD tube are in pleural space. Retaining stitch is taken at level of skin. ICD tube has definite number. ICD bag has no definite number. ICD bag is filled with 100 cc normal saline with betadine solution before attaching to ICD tube. While attaching ICD bag to ICD tube, ICD bag should be at lower level than ICD tube. That is, ICD bag should not be at level of body or at higher level than body. Confirm the proper movement of air column with respiration. Now, the step of mobilization of colon. Ascending colon and descending colon are retroperitoneal organs. They are attached and hence fixed to posterior abdominal wall by congenital adhesion of parietal peritoneum. Ascending colon and descending colon are mobilized along white line of told. While mobilizing ascending colon or descending colon, it is essential to make this white line of told prominent. So, during mobilization of ascending colon, operating surgeon standing on right side while assistant surgeon standing on left side, then assistant surgeon pulls cecum and ascending colon to left and gives traction. Also, the right side of skin incision is retracted with Doyne's retractor for better exposure. The coils or loops of small intestine after covering with the wet mops retracted upward and to left. Two artery forceps are applied to make fold of posterior peritoneum just lateral to the ascending colon. Incision is made in this fold of peritoneum with stele. The gap thus created is extended so that index and middle finger of left hand of operating surgeon can be inserted. After inserting index and the middle finger of left hand of the operating surgeon with cautery, ascending colon is mobilized along thickened relatively avascular white line of told bit by bit, taking care that incision is taken closer to colonic wall. If incision is taken away from colonic wall, there is risk of injury to major vessels. If one is carrying out dissection in proper plane, one does not find fat. If fat is seen, it is either fat of mesocolon, retroperitoneal fat or perinephric fat, indicating that one is in wrong plane. Once one reaches hepatic flexure, to mobilize hepatic flexure, traction is given on this right colic flexure by pulling it downward and to left to make the holding tissue prominent. This holding tissue is then coagulated and cut to release hepatic flexure. Then the part of right side of transverse colon is mobilized along bloodless line of Fawcett. To mobilize transverse colon from greater omentum, surgeon holds transverse colon in his left hand. assistant surgeon holds greater omentum upwards so as to make the junction between transverse colon and greater omentum tense and obvious. Usually the line of attachment is which is present between greater omentum and transverse colon is very much obvious because of tension. This line of attachment is near transverse colon. The fat of colon and mesocolon are large globules, while the fat of omentum is characteristically finer and granular. Attachment is separated carefully along bloodless line, preserving mesocolon. Now we'll see mobilization of descending colon. During mobilization of descending colon, operating surgeon is standing on left hand side, assistant surgeon standing on right hand side. Assistant surgeon pulls sigmoid colon and sigmoid mesocolon to left side, to right side to give traction. The left side of the skin incision is retracted with Doyne's retractor so as to have better exposure. The coils or loops of small intestine after covering with wet mops are retracted upward and to right. Two artery forceps are applied to make a fold of posterior peritoneum just lateral to the descending colon. In this fold of peritoneum, incision is made with steel. The gap thus created is extended so that index finger and the middle finger of left hand of operating surgeon can be inserted to display the next portion of incision. After inserting index and middle finger of left hand of operating surgeon, then the operating surgeon with cautery mobilizes the descending colon along white line of told bit by bit, taking care that incision is taken closer to colonic wall. This is because if incision is taken away from colonic wall, there is risk of injury to major vessels. Descending colon is mobilized downwards up to pelvic inlet and upwards up to splenic flexure of colon. Splenic flexure of colon is more densely organized and contains more blood vessels than hepatic flexure. To prevent splenic capsular injury and hence significant splenic injury causing bleeding, two ligaments have to be released at the level of splenic flexure of colon. These two ligaments are splenicocolic ligament and its extension called phrenicocolic ligament, and second ligament is linorenal ligament. Splenicocolic ligament is a fold of peritoneum extending from lower or anterior end of spleen in mid-axillary line to splenic flexure of colon. The same fold of peritoneum then extends upwards from splenic flexure of colon to undersurface of left side of dome of diaphragm and left 11th rib and is called as phrenicocolic ligament. To release splenicocolic ligament and its extension called phrenicocolic ligament, splenic flexure is pulled downwards and to right to make the fold of peritoneum, that is ligament prominent, which is coagulated and then cut so as to release the splenic flexure partially. The second ligament is linorenal ligament. It is the fold of peritoneum extending from hilum of spleen to posterior abdominal wall through left kidney. That is, it is a fold of peritoneum extending from spleen to anterior surface of upper part of upper pole of left kidney. To make linorenal ligament prominent, Jurotas fascia is pushed downwards and to right, which is coagulated and then cut. Left side of transverse colon is then mobilized along avascular line of object till DJ flexure, which comes in view. Due to mobilization of ascending or descending colon, retroperitoneum can be opened slowly to expose great vessels like aorta, inferior vena cava and then even ureter. After removal of adherent kidney and after confirming homeostasis and proper ligature on vascular pedicle, tube drain is inserted through separate stab incision in retroperitoneum. Open peritoneum is closed. For proper approximation of vessels, kidney bridge is lowered and wound is closed in layers after infiltration of local anesthesia in wound for multimodal pain relief. Thank you very much.